My name is Jeremiah Che Salas, and I have polymyositis. I was diagnosed about 8 years ago. Doing really well these days. Of course, everybody has a story, and we all know that we've gone through lots of trials. There are some real down points, but I feel really blessed and lucky to be where I'm at and have the health that I do and be able to do everything that I do every day and find the humor in everything. So here today, we're here to honor Mike Krukow and to support the Myositis Association for the Myositis Awareness Month. And it's going to be a great presentation, I believe, for Mike Krukow down on the field. And I am lucky enough to go down there with him. It's going to be a great honor. I could actually say meeting Mike Krukow, top five people. And, you know, so I could check that off the bucket list, really. So.
And who did you bring here?
I brought accompanying me is my caregiver and wife, my partner. My best half.
Adrienne Rhodes. I have polymyositis. I got sick in 2006. I wasn't diagnosed until 2012. I was working as a special ed teacher at the time, and I've since left the classroom because of all the medications I'm on, and my immune system's lowered, so I get sick too easy. Uh-huh. Yeah, now I just work part-time at Target.
What meds are you on?
Oh, prednisone, doxycycline, methotrexate, rituximab, acetazolamide. Oh, there's one more. Referent, yeah.
You got the whole
I do, yes. Yes, I'm in a quasi-remission right now, but they still want to keep me on the infusions.
So you're doing pretty well at the moment?
Yes, right now I am, yes. I have been for about 6 months now. Yeah.
That's great, thanks. Yeah. And where do you live, in the area?
San Rafael, yeah. I'm volunteering today for Myositis Awareness Day. I am a Giants fan, born and raised in the Bay Area, so.
Another one of our famous members.
To celebrate Myositis Awareness Day, which is today. And it turns out that Mike Krukow also has myositis. He has IBM. And so we're here to support him as well. And the Giants have offered to make it aware. But my partner does.
We have Giants souvenirs today. Complimentary
gifts. So I'm a partner of a polymyositis person. Right. And they don't get enough advertising like muscular dystrophy does because we don't have a spokesperson like Jerry Lewis. So maybe Mike Krukow will make people more aware.
Hi. I'm Sue Carpenter.
Yeah.
And I actually.
Have a good day.
Yeah, everybody has probably their own specific story of what they go through. Being diagnosed about 8 years ago, I went from being extremely physically active person, borderline competitive sports athlete as well. Did a lot of mountain biking and backpacking, and then lost close to 40 pounds, 50 pounds in about 3 months, and didn't know what was going on. I thought it was, I hurt my back or something. And it took a while before I was finally diagnosed with polymyositis. And daily challenges, daily pain in all of my joints here and there. Because of the muscle loss, it is difficult to climb stairs or any kind of incline, basically. Everything from picking up a piece of paper from the ground to taking a shower, everything you can think of is a challenge. I sometimes compare it to, if you were to strap on 50 to 60 pounds onto your back and chest and just carry that around for the whole day. That's kind of what it's like. It's great. I've been going to these keep in touch meetings that we have with other myositis patients, and we all get to share stories with each other about our daily challenges and medical issues and stuff. We can only get so much information out there to our friends and the public, but to have someone like Mike, who is kind of front and center, it's all, he's kind of like, he's our all-star, on our myositis team. So he's the guy that's the star player right now that can kind of get the word out there, to everybody else and just share some basic information. If anything, just have a couple of people ask, what is myositis? Why does Mike walk around with a cane, and what is he going through? So it's huge to have him kind of as our spokesperson.
Awesome, and we kind of touched on it a little bit, but Mike is still up in the broadcast booth doing what he loves, and does that help you or encourage you to keep doing the things you love?
Anything confirms my positive attitude and the positive attitudes that I hear from other patients. He has that drive that a lot of us do to kind of get through, to survive. It's nice to know that Mike is there, and he's kind of going through a lot of the same stuff that we're going through. Maybe when he hears a few stories, he'll feel that way, or he already does about some of the patients that are out there going through some of the things that he's going through.
Yeah, I was diagnosed in December of 2009, so it's been almost 6 years.
And so what sort of challenges have you faced since then, living with myositis?
Initially, there was a lot. With polymyositis, the type I had, immediately had muscle wasting, lung disease. I was in a wheelchair for about 9 months at the beginning, kind of bedridden, but it was kind of perfect timing too, because that was the year the Giants first won the World Series, so I was able to watch virtually every game on TV that year. And people would ask me, how do you think the Giants are going to do this year? And right from the beginning, I was saying, I think they're going to win the World Series. I really think it's possible this year. And people just look at me and think, it must be the Mets talking. But they did. And there are different types of myositis. The type he has comes on kind of slow, and you can see it progressing. But from what I've heard and what I've been researching, there's some promising things out there. That's why it's hopeful that people will donate and work toward these cures, because I think they're pretty close on some of these. With a disease, you never know. Around the corner could be something really bad, but also when things are bad, there's a good chance it's going to get better.
So then how do you overcome some of these challenges and keep doing what you love to do and have a positive attitude?
Yeah, a lot of doctors and nurses and stuff said that the best thing is that you have a positive attitude. Maybe just because you're overwhelmed with everything at first, I guess I had a positive attitude just because, what are you going to do, sit around and cry about it? Today I'm going to try to get out of my bed and make it over to the wheelchair. And if you do it, it's a success. It's good to look back and remember that occasionally, that how low you were at a certain point. Doing great now. So, And everybody, this disease is so different for everybody. That's the thing. You talk to people, and but I think it's important for people that are doing real poorly to know that there's a good chance that things will turn around. So.
And then what does it mean to you to have the support of the Giants on a day like today and bringing awareness?
It's a big deal. Yeah, it's a big, I'm a huge Giants fan, and big fan of Mike Krukow, and to see that he's helping bring awareness to this disease, I think is a really important thing. And it's not just in the Bay Area, there are people all over that are excited about it. I think Giants have gained fans all over the country with myositis patients. I talk to people at TMA conference last week from North Florida, and they're all gathering in a bar in Tallahassee or somewhere today to watch the Giants game.
My name is Catherine Navard, and I was diagnosed about 3.5 years ago with dermatomyositis. Day-to-day life, the one thing that's difficult for me is that it's invisible. So it's an invisible illness that you live with. You're always tired. Medication is very difficult because they put you on such strong medications that the side effects can be difficult. But for the most part, dermatomyositis is accompanied by a rash, weakness. I lost all of my muscle from my hips up, and I was actually very fortunate that I was diagnosed early on, and I caught it early, that I didn't lose the muscle from my hips down. So I was still able to walk, but I was unable to do simple things like wash my hair, taking a shower was difficult, or even getting out of bed. I mean, you just have to make adjustments in your lifestyle. So you have to pick a few things that day that you want to do, and just know that maybe those other things have to wait until tomorrow. I'm fortunate enough to live with a very loving partner that helps me out every day and takes care of me. And, you know, I just do day-by-day activities. I used to be a runner. I ran the San Francisco Marathon. I used to be a Big Ten softball player. So you lose these things in yourself, but you just have to find something new. So I do a lot of yoga, try and eat healthy, day-to-day activities that keep you going, do more art or music, and just picking up new things. So I have to say, I think my life almost started when I got diagnosed with myositis.
That sounds really impressive. So you've really kind of jumped into new hobbies, new activities.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, new hobbies, new activities, and just really living life day to day. I still work my 40-hour a week job that I love, and know that if I need to, I can work from home. So you just have to make little simple changes in your life. You know, it is difficult. You kind of lose a part of yourself, I think, when you're diagnosed, but you're also just starting a new life again and really living by the moment.
Can you touch a little bit more on the idea that your life started when you were diagnosed?
I think your life starts because when you lose everything, you really find yourself in order to survive. So I felt that I lost all movement. You know, you just lose your body to this. You lose your health. And then it's like that love comes out from your friends and family. And even the Myositis Association, they reach out and say, hey, here's a support group for you. You know, there are people like you out here. And, you know, with the Myositis Association, that was the first time I've ever met anyone else with my disease because it's so rare. So now I still keep in touch with the people I meet at the conference, phone calls once a month, and you have that support.
So Mike Krukow brought a lot of visibility to that, mm-hmm. to myositis recently. What is it like having him for an advocate?
I think it's really exciting, and I'm very proud of him to step out and disclose that he has myositis, because that's something that's very difficult among any chronic illness, I think, is to disclose your status and say, hey, this is something I'm dealing with. But when you do that, people will reach out to you and say, I have this too, and that's where you're going to find your support and be able to open up. So I'm very happy that it's bringing light to the disease. Yeah, you know, everyone has their own challenges, and it's really just nice to share what you go through, and that everyone does continue to do what you love. This shouldn't be able to stop you. Sure, I may not run a marathon again, but for me, walking to the grocery store is my marathon now. You know, I can walk there and walk back, and I get my exercise, and I keep up with my yoga, and now I feel I'm more centered and better at yoga than I was before the disease, because you understand yourself more and your body, and what you're going through. So I think you pick up little pieces from everyone with the support that you get from Myositis Association.
Yes. My name is Donna Misa, and I'm a native San Franciscan and lifetime Giants fan. And I was diagnosed with IBM about 2.5 years ago.
And what sort of day-to-day challenges do you have you had to face?
You know, life has become an interesting adventure and challenge. And I think some of my greatest ambitions are just being able to stand up every day and to be able to walk. And so now a great adventure is brushing teeth, brushing hair, just activities of daily living are now really an amazing part of time-consuming the day.
Well, you seem to have a really positive outlook on everything. How do you stay positive?
Well, you know, I stay positive by, you know, first of all, I rely solely on God nowadays for just being all my strength. But then I look at people like Mike Krukow, and I think if Mike could do all the traveling he does and all, you know, work a night game and then work a day game, then you know what? I can do more too and do stuff. So he's an inspiration to me, as well as other folks that have this disease. You know, if I can explain this disease, it's kind of like either trying to move in quicksand or slowly turning to stone. It's just, it's the weirdest disease with just the most peculiar things.
As a Giants fan, having Mike Krukow as an advocate must be really cool.
You know, it's fantastic. And again, I'm so sorry for anybody that has this disease, especially Mike. And, you know, I do pray for strength for all of our patients every day, including Mike. And but it is, it's just, it's wonderful, I think, now that Mike has shared. And, you know, it's given me the boldness to be able to say, you know, I have this disease and it's okay. Because as we raise awareness, I think we'll be able to raise fundraising. And this disease is considered orphan. So there's not a lot of money being spent on research. There's a couple things in the pipeline. But for those of us that are fighting minute to minute, hour to hour, it can't come soon enough. So I think with this awareness, with Mike helping us, with the fundraising that'll be done in his honor, I think it's going to do wonderful things to help push maybe some viable solutions, if not cures, maybe treatments that can help us slow down the symptoms of this really horrible disease.
My name's Ed Horak. I was diagnosed in September of 2013 with inclusion body myositis. It's hard to be active to be with IBM. I used to play hockey. Matter of fact, my wife and I just went to Charles Schultz Museum up in Santa Rosa. And I always had in my mind I was going to play hockey into my 70s like he did. And I couldn't do that. I was losing my hockey stick. And I was starting to fall. Unlike Donna, I hadn't had a lot of falls on dry ground. But skates made it a little bit different to pick that foot up and move. My hands are a big thing. I like to play golf, and the golf club was flying out of my hand and endangering my partners when I played. So it's made life a little less active for me, and it's, you know, at the end of the day, you kind of feel like you're walking in quicksand or you're carrying around two lead pipes. So, I've always been a positive person anyways, and, you know, I had sort of lived by the philosophy that things could be worse. I mean, when we first got diagnosed, a lot of us, it was pretty clear that to doctors that we had ALS. So you start that there. I don't have ALS. I continue to hope that every day that there's a cure coming, and I work every day doing exercise, not like I used to do, to try to keep whatever mobility I have in play. I'm competitive, so I, for the longest time, I tried to figure out how to keep the golf club in my hand by using straps for my hockey shin pads and Velcroing it in, and using Stick'Em and a few other things. And that all worked for a bit, but when it got cold or rainy, you know, coming from Boston, that happens a lot, it wouldn't work. So a friend of mine came up with a glove that has a little loop on it that keeps the golf club in my hand. So I could still do that, and that kind of keeps me going. So, it is what it is. Life gives you stuff, and you got to kind of take it and roll with it. Well, no, I love Krukow. Mm-hmm. As a matter of fact, I think my diagnosis follows him exactly. I think I was diagnosed at the exact same age he was. So it's interesting to me to see where he's going. And in Boston, we have Jerry Remy, right? So I can imagine how much Krukow's loved out here. if Krukow, if Remy was coming up with something like this, people would rally around him. So I'm really not happy anyone would get this diagnosis, but it's nice to see somebody who has a stage and a platform to have it that can sort of be our voice.
So Jim Remmer is not going to be here today. He has inclusion body myositis, and like many others, unfortunately, he had a fall yesterday, and serious enough that he ended up going to the emergency room and ended up being admitted to the hospital. So unfortunately, he's not going to be going on the field, but we have four other patients that are going on the field, and we wish Jim well, and hopefully we'll see him again soon. So Jim, actually, he did not have a diagnosis. He saw the article that appeared in the papers out on the West Coast when Krukow announced that he had inclusion body myositis, and after reading about it, he decided that that might be what he has, and so he went and talked to his physician, and sure enough, he has inclusion body myositis, and in essence, Mike Krukow helped him find a diagnosis which he was searching for, so kind of an interesting story, and he's probably not the only one that found out about their disease by reading about it.
Thanks. Bob, how you doing?
Good to see you. I don't know if you just heard that. One of our patients read the article that came out when you announced it at IBM. Anyway, that's how he realized that he had what you have. He went to the doc and he got diagnosed, and then as luck would have it, last night he had a fall, and he went to the emergency room and got admitted to the hospital, so he's not going to come on the field. He's not here to go on the field today, but the interesting story where, this is one of our,
he just walked in, so okay. I wanted you to turn it over and introduce.
Yeah, I wanted me to just introduce you. Anyway, Mike Peck has polymyositis, and he does a lot of filming for the Myositis Association. Yes. And so,
how are you?
Nice to meet you. Good.
Welcome.
Thank you.
Okay, so I think, I'm from the East Coast. I know all you West Coast folks know Mike, so I don't need to introduce him. But everybody here are patients and guests and spouses. And
so who are the patients?
Well, it's our club.
So does anybody know how we got this thing? Any ideas?
Sins of my past.
I was thinking the same thing. Should have drank more Guinness, I guess, But nice of you all to come. We have a job to do. So today we'll stand in unison and, our crowd, I mean, there won't be 41,000 when we get out there. We usually don't assemble in mass in this ballpark till about the second or third inning. That's when everybody gets here. But the message is going to get out, maybe not so much to the people that actually hear us in the stadium, but what is going to be written and what is going to be put on the air, and with the hopes that, we'll get some more answers. That's the plan. I know all of you have met Bob, and you know him quite well, and he is our driving force. And I don't know if you guys have had the same situations happen to you that have happened to me, but what's happened to me is, after getting diagnosed, there's this big void. Oh, really? So what now? What treatment? Well, there is no treatment, which is kind of a hard deal for anybody to even fathom. How can there not be a treatment? Well, we don't know how you get it. What does that even mean? And these are the things we're dealing with. So we have each other. And through Bob, we can, share our thoughts. And, if I find a cure, a homemade cure, where if you hop on one foot, rub peanut butter on your forehead, then it is a difference maker, I will let you know. But I expect the same thing from you guys. Because at this point, the doctors really aren't doing much good for us. But, you're not in braces. How many falls have you taken?
35.
Yeah.
35?
Yeah.
Six required first responders, but then I have a really strong husband and son, and they can deadlift me off the ground, because I'm not a small person.
Do you use braces?
No, not yet. I'm not yet.
Get braces. That'll help.
You look good with skirts, I'm sure.
They got maxis. Come on. Go along. The sticks and the braces, night and day, that cut my falls in by 80%.
Wow, okay.
You know, and every step is a calculation, you know. And that was really hard for me because I was always, you know, I would fly everywhere around the kitchen and room, wherever. So you anticipate it. My biggest fear is when we go on the road trips, we fly charter. Bus drives right up to the plane, and then there's a stairwell that goes from here to the ceiling. And it's like Mount Everest every time.
Yeah.
And not so much going up, but coming down.
Yeah.
So I'm coming down the center like this, you know, and I got like 30 professional baseball players, you know, waiting to catch me should I go down. We don't always have that same support group. But braces work. There's a number of different types that you can use. I've used them all. I started with just one on my left leg, and then, you know, now I've got them on both legs. Some of like a Velcro wrap, but they really, really help. And they give you that added support, especially when you're stepping down. So nobody else is on canes?
Not everybody has IBM here. Some of these folks have polymyositis. Jay has poly, and Kate over there has dermatomyositis. So, you know, there are treatments for those forms of the disease. But Ed over here has IBM, and his story he was sharing with me is kind of like yours. Ed, you want to tell me?
As I looked into, and, you know, no one wants to see anyone get diagnosed with this, but it had to be just months before you got diagnosed. I was saying to Marianne Moyer, the organized chairman of the KIC group, that we need somebody with some notoriety to get this disease. And I'm sorry it was you, but whatever you can do to help helps. And as I look back, you got diagnosed, I think you're about 8 years older than me, and you got diagnosed right about the same time. So, you know, think as when you got diagnosed, I want to say, so what's, you know, I wanted to call you and say, what's it been like? You know, when did you have your first fall? I've been, someone asked me if there were stages of this thing like cancer. So I would suggest I'm stage one, but stage one isn't all that pretty either. Mm-hmm. We went on a walking tour last night of San Francisco for like a dine around in the Italian section, which was interesting because we went through Chinatown, the red light district, and what finally looked like the Italian section. But like those walk, that's brutal. And, you know, not like you, but I was active. I played hockey. I played golf. My first sign was not losing distance. I always thought I wasn't all that good anyways. But my first sign was my golf club was coming flying out of my hand. And, you know, the idea that I couldn't do those things anymore. I mean, hockey's out of the question. But I'm hanging on to golf with a handicap glove and a...
What do you do for your hands?
I do putty, therapeutic putty.
Don't stop that. Get an instrument.
Like a musical instrument?
Yep.
So we were just talking about this. You shifted to drums from string
instruments. No, I'm still doing strings.
But you think that...
But I'm doing drums too.
So what if I'm not musically inclined?
Well, that's a great question. Because you have to remember that you're not going to be playing at Carnegie Hall anytime soon.
So I was thinking about this because I've always had this sort of secret thing that I want to play the guitar, but I would...
Start with a ukulele.
Really, why? Because it's small.
Well, it's just basically the same chords as a guitar. It's a light gauge. It's easier on your hands. And, you know, just go off on yourself. Just for a half hour a day.
My lower hands have very little functionality. So you tell me I can do what I need to do with that with a...
Well, I don't know how much hand strength you have in there. But, yeah, because you'll see an improvement. If there's one thing I've learned about this thing is that... the more aggressive you are with your exercise, you can sustain some strength. But the drum thing is really cool because you can get a drum, and there's a bunch of world market, and I suggest this for all of you. They call them world instruments. Djembe drums, Dumke drums, Tablas drums. Get a drum. They're not expensive. And for $150, you're going to get a really good one. And just go on... you have a stereo at home or whatever source of music that you have, get reggae on there or get we have a lot of guys on our team that are Latin players, and they're turning me on to a lot of the Latin music, which is a great drum beat, right? So get some salsa and just get a drum and just start banging away. And it's really good for your upper body strength. It's really good for your hands. I can't tell you how, I'm on it every day, every day. Well, for your shoulders, because we're losing so much energy and muscle tone and strength from our, you know, our upper arms, it provides you with a workout. And there's another instrument I just bought, they're really hard to get, they're called hand pans. And it's, if you can imagine a steel drum, which is a concave drum. Have you guys seen the steel drums? Well, somebody, some genius, flipped it over. Now it's convex, and it looks like an egg, circular. And there's 10 or 12 notes on it. You should Google handpan, or go onto YouTube, handpan. And it's an unbelievable instrument. And it just requires just hitting it like a drum, and you get different notes, and it's spectacular. So get those, I mean, get on one of those instruments, especially now. Don't wait. The putty's great. I mean, I flip a ball constantly. I've been doing that my whole career, and that's helped my hand strength. Because, you know, I go around the country and I see a lot of people at ballparks who just have heard my story, and they'll come in and they want it, they have questions. And a lot of them have their hands are shot, you know. And these are guys that are early 60s, late 60s. And I encourage them, you know, go back in, do the drums. And guys who I've seen 2 years that have been on this thing, they're maintaining their hand strength. So the erosion has stopped, or at least slowed down.
We were at the conference last week, and there was a lot of talk about exercise. And when I first was diagnosed, I was like, Christ, you know, if I lift weights, I'm going to break down the muscle. But, you know, if you do a very light regimen, very high rep, the muscle that you have, you're at least feeding it blood, and you're allowing it to, you know, maintain itself, at least in theory. But, you know, I agree with you, you know, there's, at first, when the first disease first came out, they told people not to exercise. And I think that's a big mistake.
Yeah, I do too.
That's all I still do is yoga, bike.
But do you get in the water?
Pardon?
Do you swim? Or do aerobics in the water?
That's one of my things. I tried water aerobics and it has helped. Yeah. But it's interesting because everyone I talk to here used to be an athlete. And so it's really common, like if it's hockey or baseball or running, everyone here used to do that. So now it's like, what do? When you can't do that anymore. But for me, it's just like yoga and biking. I mean, it saved my life to get on the trail. But,
good. You know, how old are you now?
33. Mm-hmm.
Good. Get on it now.
28, so, yeah.
Well, you look great.
Thanks. The hard part is it's invisible.
Yeah.
Right?
You been doing any drums?
No, I haven't. But I have a ukulele and a mandolin.
Get on them.
Yeah, well, thank you.
Ukulele's a little bit easier than the mandolin. And you know what? If the mandolin's too hard to play, there's 8 strings on a mandolin. Take 4 of them off.
Right, or just the 4 on the uke will be fine.
Uke's great. But yeah, get after it.
That's a great idea.
I wish I could give you some tips on food. You know, we've been researching, you know, I've a pretty clean diet. Mm-hmm. And I don't see a difference. If I have a lot of sugar and around Thanksgiving and an extra piece of pie or something, I don't see a difference.
That's a huge difference.
How do you see it?
Well, I also have fibromyalgia, so it's painful. So my whole body.
So you get you light up, you get inflamed.
Mm-hmm. So if like caffeine, which I had this morning, gluten, which I just had, and alcohol, if I have those 3 things, I notice I'm more painful. Like basically the entire next week, I feel really tired. I'll get headaches and I'm in pain. But if I have a clean diet, I feel great. That and an exercise. Mm-hmm. They say autoimmunity starts from your gut. 80% of your immune system is in your gut. So if you have a clean gut, it'll help you out.
Anything to add?
Well, I'm a caretaker, so Ed? This whole musical instrument thing is scaring me.
Get earplugs for you.
Yeah. No, but I'd like to meet your wife, if your wife's around at some point.
Yeah, she'll be here. She'll be...
Because she's an important part of the equation, too.
She doesn't want to talk about my diet.
Yeah, we won't go there.
Wrong. I could live on garlic fries.
Yeah. Like, I shouldn't drink coffee.
You know, Che's been very inspiring. He's a nurseryman, and he's worked through this entire thing. So I agree with you. Everybody that we seem to have met that's been afflicted by myositis of some kind has been very athletic. Mm-hmm. So it's very interesting common thread that you guys seem to share.
That is interesting.
40 hours a week.
Yeah, so he's kept working 40 hours a week all 8 years that he's had it, and I don't know how he does it. So I'm just amazed.
Also, it saved me as we don't own a car. So we bike everywhere. So I have to bike to get somewhere. So I used to bike 6 miles to work.
Do it.
Yeah.
I survivors. Push yourself.
Yeah, you push yourself.
So you're polymyositis?
Went from, you know, almost 200 pounds down to about 160 within about 3 months. Lost a lot of my core muscles. And yeah, falls all the time, really. I kind of just, sometimes my knee just kind of gives out. And then there's no muscle to kind of catch it after it goes out. And you just fall to the ground. And
are you
looking?
Did you say that?
I just fell.
Yeah. I know. It's a concern. I mean, you just have to calculate every step.
Yeah.
Places you can't go.
I remember it was, you know, basically just going outside of the door at that little threshold, 2-inch step. You got to time that perfectly. Downstairs, the curb, getting into the car. Like you said, everything is calculated. When we go to ball games, it's like, okay, where are we sitting? Are there handrails going up to that, the seats, or can I talk with somebody down along the front row and see if maybe they'll trade seats with me? Yeah.
Same with kind of vitamin public transit. I've fallen on unit before because I don't look sick, so I couldn't sit down on a crowded bus, and I've fallen just when they started, so it's hard.
It's a good reason to carry a cane sometimes.
Yeah. That doesn't work all the time.
Sometimes,
especially someone
down
my age.
Yeah.
I was actually amazed. I had a hip replacement back in April, and I was really nervous about having it because I figured it would cut into some of the muscles and I would already grow them. But they came in posteriorly, and it was actually pretty good. But I was using a cane at that time. And I was amazed at how people just don't care.
Yeah.
I'm walking on with this cane, and I'm walking sort of attentively. People are bumping into me. And, you know, sometimes that hockey mentality comes out. And you can,
but it's just poke people.
Yeah, and I was, Katie Wiesbach, a kit leader in New York, said she did just the same thing. She carried a cane so that people would, you know, give her a little room, and you know, it doesn't always work.
Well, it doesn't hurt.
It doesn't hurt, but I tell you, the thing you said is like, you know, I was always pretty hyperactive and I walked at a quick pace, and now I'm just, you know, I walked every step.
Mm-hmm.
I'm watching whatever I step on, and you know, make sure I, you know, you examine the curb, the pavement that you're on, is it cracked, is there something I can catch myself on, and I walk slower.
And
I haven't had, I only had one fall.
I'm taking
and I've been lucky.
Here.
But I, you know, I can see it coming just because if you, you know, just trying to be very careful and avoid it.
It slows you down, no doubt. But it's doable. When I got diagnosed, I was over at the ALS Center in San Francisco, and I walked in there, and there was about six guys there who had ALS. There were six with MS and myself. So I didn't know what it was. I knew it was serious. When the guy told me I had IBM, but I didn't have ALS and MS, you know, I kind of felt like I won the lottery. I didn't really know what it was in store for. That was 3-4 years ago, but you know, it's doable. It's doable, and it helps when you have somebody you can bounce some ideas on. It helps when you have somebody who says, "Oh no, don't do that." And so I do believe we have to help ourselves, because I get the same thing from our doctor. He's a great guy, really good doctor. Got nothing for me. It's like, what's up with that? Why? Make something up.
I had the opposite reaction when they told me they've ALS, I had IBM. I, you know, you're something, and the doctor's only advice was, I said, well, what do I do? You know, do I, you know, can I work out? Can I do PT? He said, well, go shop for a ranch. So if you're going to be in a wheelchair in 8 years, go figure it out. And so, you know, people are calling you to congratulate you. Wasn't feeling good about
it. I was happy.
She was.
I was happy you didn't have ALS.
She was convinced.
Yeah.
You know, that scary period of April to September.
Yeah.
It looked pretty convincing that you have ALS.
Yeah. Yeah. So, oh well. So Red Sox fans, huh?
Yes, sir.
Maybe.
So how's it? You got the panda from us.
We did.
Do you want to give them back?
No, no, you know, the most athletic guy of that size I've ever seen in my life. Like IBM.
He does not have IBM.
So when he gets up, when he gets on the ball, it's amazing. He's got a cannon for an arm. Occasionally he loses it, the ball goes up to the right field.
We loved him. He's just full of energy and whatnot. The very first time you get traded, and I think every player needs to get traded because it helps you grow up. You go from homeboy, and here he was the fan favorite ever since he came up. And he came up to this team when we were very bad, right after Barry Bonds. And he was the guy that kind of everybody just adopted. He's a kid. He's a big kid. And to put him in that environment first year, it's going to be a culture shock. He'll get better. He'll figure it out.
You know, the problem I had was handling the Paris. That was a waste. But the Panda, he's got a lot of energy. I think he'll hit better as time goes on. But I don't know. I try and get the sense here. This seems to be a pretty intense baseball culture, too, although Fenway's probably unique.
How many times have you been to games here?
This is my first time, Mario.
This is a great environment. I was fortunate enough as a player to be able to play. I played with the Cubs, so I'm in the Midwest. I played for the Phillies. I got the East Coast. And then I came here to San Francisco after I was 7 years in the big leagues. And the crowd out here is fantastic. They know the game. And what has happened here at AT&T is this place has just become a family reunion every day. And you'll see that. We've lost some of the air in the balloon has definitely left. Because our season is basically being decided, and that's always a tough time when you're the defending champs. Red Sox fans know what I'm talking about. But you'll like it.
It's an odd year.
My wife, Jennifer?
Yes.
My daughter, Tessa?
Hello. Hi.
All right.
And they were asking where you were.
Yeah.
We're here.
So you're about ready to start moseying out?
Yeah, what we're going to do is we're going to start heading to the field. The ceremony is at 12:45, so we'll have time to get out there. And we'll be on the field. You just have to stand and enjoy, take in this great atmosphere that you're soon to experience with our fans when you're out there on the field. And Rennell, who's our public address announcer, who is the best in all of baseball, she will be emceeing everything from the booth, and then she'll turn it over to Mike on the field. So you just all need to stand there and support one another, and then we'll walk off the field and get everybody to their seats, and you're going to come with me. I'm going to take care of you.
Of course. Hi, Greg. She's also one of the writers and producers of the upcoming teenage movie as well as Southern Charles. Yes.
Joined by Ed Horak,
Donna Misa, Jay Salas, Adrian Rose, and Catherine Navarre, as well as Bob Goldberg, Executive Director of the Myositis Association, and Juliet Dunn, Chair of the Giants Community Fund Health Committee. The Myositis Association is a nonprofit, patient-based organization dedicated to improving the lives of people affected by IBM, primarily through awareness and raising funds for research. To date, the Myositis Association has funded 34 research projects totaling more than $5 million. And today, we hope to increase the funds raised and ask each of you to consider donating by texting Krukow to 27722 or logging on to myositis.org. As part of this campaign, the Giants Community Fund and the Giants have made a $5,000 donation in honor of Krukow and all those afflicted with IBM. And now, everyone, it is my honor to turn the microphone over to our beloved Mr. Mike Krukow.
Standing up here with some of my newest friends, and we just had an opportunity to meet for about the last 45 minutes, and we were comparing notes, as we have a lot in common. We walk funny, we wear braces on our legs, we walk with canes, we take falls just to stay in shape, kind of how we roll. In fact, we had one another member of our little entourage up here who was diagnosed after he heard my story last year, and he did indeed have IBM, and he was looking forward to being here today, but last night he took a fall and he's in the hospital today, so he's not going to be here. And the things that we also have in common is that when we go to the doctor's office and we talk to our physician, we get the same answer every time. Hey, good to see you. Got nothing new for you. There's no real information on this disease. You don't know how you get it, and there's no cure for it. There are some studies now that are going on that we're kind of excited about, but you know, they give you a projection date of 2020, 2022, and I'm a little more impatient with that. What we wanted to accomplish today, we wanted to just basically let you know that we're here. We're the group. We support one another, and we're looking for your support as well. The Myositis Foundation is kind of it's a charity that doesn't have a lot of glamour to it. There is no such thing as a bad charity. Every person who is afflicted with a disease needs help. We help each other, and you have always reached out and helped everybody who has asked for your hand. And that's what I'm doing today. The person said to me before, as I started reintroducing ourselves and underneath the stands, you know, we were waiting for somebody famous because nobody was really listening. So, well, I don't know if I'm the famous guy or not, but I will definitely make a claim. And this is all about awareness. We are the Myositis Foundation. Thank you for listening. And go Giants.
See how long they'll let you stand?
I just want to
nice holiday in San Francisco. But it was really nice to meet Mike Krukow and other patients, and it's been a great day.
You want a wristband?
Well done, thank you.
Oh, yeah, awesome. Thank you.
Thank you.